is a Metro Talk, an initiative by Metropolis, the World Association of the Major Metropolises, in collaboration with its partners.
Welcome to another session of Metro Talk. Today we are together with the International Union of Public Transport, with his Secretary General Mohamed Mezgani, and as well with Hanne Nordli. She is the Market Director of the Norwegian Railway Directorate, but as well she's the Chair of the UITP Transport and Urban Life Committee. So welcome to you, the two of you. And today we are focusing on transport and mobility and the impact in cities, especially big cities and metropolitan areas. We all know that because of the pandemic, one of the issues that was on the table of every city leader was mobility, and the changes and stress that was put in mobility, especially public mobility and citizens. Do you think, I mean, just to get started, that the pandemic introduced new patterns of mobility, or it was already accelerating some of the processes that we already had in our cities? I don't know, what do you think, Mohamed?
Thank you, Octavio. Thank you for organizing this talk, actually. Mobility has been in the center of this pandemic, because the first reaction when this pandemic started was to lock down cities. And during this lockdown, we have seen first the place that cars are using in the cities, are occupying in our cities, and we have seen all these empty roads and the space that roads are taking in our cities. And also we have seen how essential public transport is during this pandemic, because when the city closed, public transport doors remained open. And we have seen the role of public transport in serving the essential workers, in serving those working in the health sector. And the role played by the transport, public transport workers, these guardians of mobility that have served those who are serving. And that's one of the lessons, I would say, I draw from this crisis. And of course, when we have seen that during the crisis, it shows that this crisis has made more important even the role of public transport and the role of mobility. And yeah, we can discuss about that maybe later.
Yeah, and I'm building on what you're saying. I read a sentence or something that is on the website of UITP, said by Hanne, is that I think you said something like, the more we integrate mass transport with flexible and on-demand mobility services, the more space we can allocate for walking and biking, and the cleaner our cities will become. But what we're witnessing now is that because of the pandemic, some people are afraid of using public transport, and some of the people are moving back to the private transport. How we get the balance right then?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I think that one of the reflections from this pandemic was that in public transport, we have been working increasingly in order to get our services market-oriented, to get our customers to come to our services, and then increasingly to integrate the different new mobility modes so that we sort of optimize the system so that we can get more space for walking and cycling and those softer modes in the cities. But the idea behind it has been that we need to transport masses of people into the city centers at peak hours. And what we're seeing now is, first of all, the demand for those transport services are low at the moment. And also because of the fear of COVID-19, people are afraid to stick too close together. So I believe that at some point, this is an opportunity to sort of accelerate the introduction of softer modes, but also maybe an opportunity to be able to flatten the curve of transport demand, because we have been planning our services for these peak traffic moments. And we have been very much concerned about getting value for money, lot of people into tight buses and metros and trains. Whereas what we see now is that we might have to think of customer orientation in a different way, because our customers might want to travel in a different way. They might be less accustomed to be too close together. But at the same time, I think we need to make sure that we belong, that we stick to some of the truths in urban and transportation planning, that we cannot transport many people in small individual modes into the city centers. So we need to continue to work on that balance. But I think that the opportunity is certainly to be able to optimize the system a little bit better now, because the travel demand is changing, not only because of fear of COVID, but also because of new habits. When we see that the way we are working now with the video meetings is increasing, and I think that that can be a trend over time. So we have new habits, and people don't necessarily need to travel at the same time every day into the city centers.
Maybe if I may, Octavi, one word about the fear of COVID, because it's right that the perception of the people some people, or most of the people, is that they don't want to go back to public transport because they are afraid of getting the virus in public transport, and some of them are using their cars, and I would say this is a perception, and it's important that we restore trust in public transport, and it's important also that we share the facts and the figures about the risk of contamination or the risk of non-contamination in public transport. And we see a number of studies now, scientific studies, empirical research, showing that public transport is COVID safe, actually. I mean, in France, for example, they publish every week the origin of clusters. And we see that only 1% of these clusters are originated in public transport system, compared to other places like bars and restaurants and family gatherings and the workplaces. And so in Germany, the same, the Robert Koch Institute has published the same figures, the UK Rail Safety Board as well. So it's important that we work, of course, to change the perception, because we have facts showing that public transport is COVID safe.
If I may add something on that, Hannah, you see that there are some debates that came now as well. They were already there, but like this idea of, for example, the 15 minutes city, you know, where you can walk more or less or go on bike to everything. But the reality, especially in big cities and metropolitan areas, that they are polycentric spaces. So it's true that, as you said, Hannah, that the new trends, people maybe not moving at the same time, everybody, there will be more people working from home, but still people will be moving across the city, you know, going to the medical areas, or where you have the hospital, where you have the universities, because you won't be able to have in any area, in all the areas of the city, a university, a hospital, a leisure center. So how you handle that?
I have to say first, I totally agree with Mohammed that we need to restore trust. We cannot plan according to a fear that is not justified. But at the same time, I think that there is an opportunity now to be able to plan for a system where we don't have the same peaks as we had before, because it's very expensive to plan for those systems. And coming from the rail sector, we are now dealing with enormous investment plans for the future in order to get enough capacity in and out of my city of Oslo. Whereas we see that maybe we don't really need that very high capacity in and out of the city, but we need people to be able to move during the day across the city, as you said, Octavi. Mm-hmm. So I think it's an opportunity to maybe get more value for the investments and the finances that we're putting into public transport. But that takes me to another point, which I think Mohammed also knows very well, and that's the troublesome financial situation for many of the companies, and also for the city authorities and for the regions. And I think that one of the things that we have had high success with in public transport all over the world is that we have we've had this market orientation, we've had private companies coming in competing for contracts, we have continuously got more customers for the money that we put into the system. And now with so much uncertainty, I think that many cities need to discuss whether the authorities need to take a stronger role in order to, as Mohammed said, to make sure that public transport is still a backbone in the mobility services. Because if we let all this up to the market to decide, it's a fear that we will get growth in private car traffic, as we already see in many cities, because the initial cost at the moment is so high.
Do you think that's really interesting, because we always go back to finance, especially when thinking about transforming the city and the investments that we need to do. Do you think, I don't know how to, because that's, I have mixed feelings. On the one hand, what I've seen, especially many metropolis members, is that with the impact of the COVID, rushing into this tactical urbanism in order to transform the streets, the roads, to give more space for bikes, for pedestrians, which is, it's very quickly to transform the city doing tactical urbanism and a low cost. But at the same time, it's part of the solution. It's not only the solution that you provide more space for citizens, that I fully agree. But at the same time, do you think there will be not a public administration, they will be scared, but at least they will rethink all the big infrastructure investments that they were going to do in terms of mobility?
If I may, it's a very important question, of course. I think we have a mathematical or an arithmetical problem here. You know, we have to move people, of course, people would like to move. And we have to optimize the use of space in the city. So these initiatives that are have been taken as a tactical urbanism, I would say, they are here to stay. And we need to dedicate more space for pedestrians. We need to dedicate more space for cycling. We need also to optimize the use of road space. And we all know that the most efficient mode for that is public transport. The most efficient mode for optimizing this road space. And so it means that we have no other choice than reducing the space dedicated to cars. And we have to limit car traffic. There is no choice. If we don't do that, I mean, the city will collapse. And your question about the 15-minute city, Octavi, is also part of this approach, of course. Because it's the 15-minute city will reduce the need to use a car, and so we need to do that, and we can also link that to the issue of financing, because that you was mentioned already by Hanne, and by introducing congestion charging, for example, road pricing, because then we can, if we do that, we can limit the use of cars, and we can also use part of the revenue generated from congestion charging to fund alternative mobility solutions, including cycling, including public transport, better working conditions, et cetera, et cetera. So we can, at the end, combine all of them in a coherent approach, which will be about moving people and not moving cars at the end.
But I think as well, then, you're introducing something as well, something new in the debate, and maybe Hanne can enlighten us with that, is because it's the citizens' involvement. And just bringing a discussion that we had with some colleagues, saying, okay, why we need to, because they are part of the citizens, and they think, oh, now they are forbidding cars. Now we are not allowed to use cars. They don't want cars into the city. Right? And they reduce it only at the in terms of pollution and quality of air. And I heard some people saying, but now that we're moving to electrical cars, then the issue of pollution is not a problem. And it's very interesting because you, Mohammed, talk about the issue of collapsing the city. So it's not only about pollution, it's about collapsing the city. But how you shift the cultural approach or the minds of people in terms of the use of car?
Yeah, I think it's an important question and also a very difficult question, because I think we need to work continuously on keeping the trust of the public. From our experience here in Norway, we've had these toll rings around cities for many years already, and they have been accepted because the public has seen that the money has been spent on public transport and services. But we had a change a couple of years ago when the charges were they're rising, and also because of discussion about electric cars, and we don't really pollute that much anymore. And I think that now with the communication from the national authorities about public transport and the fear that this is putting into the public, we need to sort of push again back that communication so that we make ensure the public that this is actually still for your best. it's better for you and for the cities that we continue to not allow too many cars into the city centers, and that we continue to build a system where that is based on a balance between public transport and softer modes. But I think it's going to be much harder now, basically because of the fear of safety that COVID-19 is putting into the public, and that has also been so communicated from health authorities. And as Mohammed said, we need to continue to show the proof that this is not really the most unsafe place you can be in terms of COVID. But it's a tough communication job.
Sure. And maybe coming back to the question of electric cars, you know, we in the sustainability approach, environment is only one component. I mean, it's not because we will solve the environmental issue that we will make our cities more sustainable. Mm-hmm. And I used to say that a clean traffic jam is still a traffic jam. So it's not because all our cars are electric that we will solve the mobility issue. No, we need really to tackle or to address all problems simultaneously. I mean, the problem of road space, the problem of environment, the problem of social inclusion, you know, the problem of road safety, because electric cars won't be safer than diesel cars or benzene cars. So it's important that we have this integrated approach.
To take a more positive approach, though, because we are focusing on the problems, maybe. I think that some of the experiences in many cities is not only are cities now reallocating space, but people's habits are also changing. So people are sort of suddenly starting to bike to work and realizing that that's actually a very good way of commuting. And I think that we need to lift those examples and you know, get people to explain to each other that this is actually positive for the city environment, that we're, more of us are moving in an active mode.
But do you think, and we both, well, you two and myself, we both are part of international global organizations with members from all around the world. Some may could think that we are having a global north debate. The discussion so far. Do you think all these discussions we're having now apply also to the global south cities? I mean, in terms of there are some cities, even big cities, even in the south, that still they don't have transport systems at all, or they are chaotic, or there's more based on the informality of the transport or on the private system of transportation. So do you think that we're having a global north debate, or it's also applied to the global south, according to the trends that you see in your membership?
I think that the main difference between the South and the North, if we can make this distinction, is more about governance and less about resources or about funding or it's about governance, about the fact that unfortunately in most of the South countries they don't have the governance structure. They don't give enough priority to the management of transport issues, to the governance of transport issues, and many countries they see transport only as building roads. But you're right to mention this informal transport modes. For example, these are very flexible solutions. You know what we are doing now in the northern countries is copying the flexibility of the informal transport. We have in the northern countries, maybe we have digital informal transport. That's the main difference. But they are copying the philosophy of informal transport. So this informal transport for me should be regulated, should be improved, and should be really upgraded to become a part of the solution together with the mass public transport. So we need more investment in mass public transport, but we need to keep the benefits of this informal transport in the system, and we need to have the governance structure, really, PTA, public transport authorities, mobility agencies, and to build this governance bodies to make it possible to manage mobility in these cities.
Really interesting what you're saying, and links to another issue is that what we're witnessing, at least the ones who were not so involved in mobility issues, well, we know, but it's not the focus of our everyday business, is that people, even city leaders, they are discovering that mobility and transportation is not, as you said, it's not only about moving people around or goods around, but it has an impact on other policies of the city, no? Environment is clear, but on safety, even about accessing to opportunities, exactly, and so on. No, that's something also new, and maybe that's also it complicates as well the way you need to sort out mobility.
You're right. It's about showing the benefits of a sustainable mobility, benefit on jobs, benefit on the economy. You know, when you invest €1 or $1 in public transport, you get €5. In the local economy, you generate €5 in the local economy. So it's about showing these benefits, that it's not just a way of moving; it's a contribution to the economy, to social inclusion, to the employment of women. In some countries, they have seen that women they don't work because they don't have they cannot access to the job place. While men, they have cars, so they can do it easily. So these kind of implications are very important, and we need to highlight them.
We are discussing in the Transport and Urban Life Committee. We are distinguishing not necessarily between northern and southern cities, but between fast-growing cities and slower-growing cities, and many of those cities are fast-growing, and in our mind, we have decided that should give an opportunity to make things right, because you have a faster pace of the growth. But of course, it's also the governance issues that Mohammed is talking about is sometimes relevant in those same cities, and that it's not necessarily that easy to put the methodology from more developed cities into those fast growing cities. But it should be an opportunity in order to try to make things right from the beginning.
And I like this idea. We're talking about fast-growing cities and slow-growing cities. But could you a bit develop that? I mean, in the fast-growing cities, which are the kind of challenges that you think that they need to face?
I guess the challenges are certainly financial again, right? Because the finances are moving after, and you need to use the market forces. But at the same time, you can develop greater areas with a methodology and a strategy that you can learn from other cities who are growing slower. Pristine land that can be developed from the beginning, and which is easier than in developed cities where you need to work with what you already have. Mm-hmm. So to that respect, I think it's an opportunity. But of course, the fast growth is also a little bit difficult to handle financially.
Fast growing and because it's a very interesting aspect. One also important, essential even aspect is the political leadership in these cities. There are very good examples coming from the south and very good examples coming from the north, and we see that the common, let's say, the element is the political leadership in the city. When you look to Bogota or to Curitiba, when Curitiba was the first to develop BRT, or to Casablanca now, the what is behind this success is the political leadership, is political champions that one day said we need to tackle this issue of mobility, and they understood the what is at stake, and they understood the benefits of improving mobility. And on their cities, of course, and they decided to do it. And I think this is something that we need to repeat and repeat again, that we need political champions that will dare to change the statu quo.
And I'm happy to hear that, because this is something that in every area of policy making in metropolis, we say to our membership that metropolitan governance, in our case, or the governance of major cities, is crucial. If you don't get right the governance, then maybe you can have resources, you can have legal frameworks, but it will happen properly. And we talk, as always, we say the first thing of governance is political leadership. If there's not political leadership and will, nothing will change. And you were giving examples, and then as well the vision of the territory, you know, how do you want your city to be and how you want to develop your city. And then it comes finance, but it's true that in our definition, finance is not the first thing. I mean, because as you said, you can have the resources, but not do things right. And of course, involving citizens. So I'm really happy to see that it's coming from you as well, the same approaches that we are developing in metropolis.
You know, just one sentence on that. One additional example are the cities from the Middle East, for example, Dubai and now Riyadh. And with the initially, they haven't planned public transport when they designed their cities. But then they realized that without public transport, the city cannot be performant. And Dubai started developing the metro 10 years ago or 15 years ago. And then now Riyadh is building 160 kilometers of metro lines simultaneously, because they understood without public transport, the city will not grow.
And of course they have money. Those two cities have.
Oh, sure, it helps.
Yeah, once you have the political will and the vision, if you have the money, then everything happens fast.
Yeah,
we are almost getting at the end of our conversation dialogue. Hanne, I don't know if you want to bring some ideas on board or just to highlight some of the things that you said about the. Well, I think this idea of how we are going to shape mobility in the aftermath of COVID.
Yeah, I think that what I want to say is that looking back at how we have been working on public transport for many years, we've had some shifts over the last years. We've had a technological shift that we have needed to work on to improve ourselves. And then we've had a financial shift in many cities where the economy going a little bit slower. And now with the COVID-19 sort of shock on the demand for mobility, I think that we could go in the cellar and just say, no, this is too much, you know, we can't handle it. Or we can look at the opportunities that it raises. And in my opinion, it really raises opportunities to continue to move forward to integrate public transport with other modes, but also maybe look at how we can manage demand in an order that we can optimize the system and get better solutions for our customers. Mm-hmm. So to me, it's a difficult situation, but I think it's an opportunity as well.
Thank you, Hani. Mohamed, I don't know if you want to add something else.
Yeah, of course, I agree with what Hani said, and it's an opportunity, and really it's a great opportunity we have. It's like we needed such a shock or such a pandemic, unfortunately, to react. And I think this is the opportunity we have, we have the opportunity to build cities for people, really, and to put people at the heart of our mobility policy, to think about health, to think about accessibility, to think about resilience, to think about, you know, environment. So now we cannot pretend that we don't know. No, now we know that we need to build cities for people. And we have these opportunities. And of course, if we want to build these cities for people, we have to think about making the quality of life better, better using the urban space, etc. And for that, public transport has of course an essential role to play for these cities for people.
That was a very nice ending for this conversation. So I would like to thank both of you for joining us today on this dialogue, and as well to thank UITP for the work that we're developing together with Metropolis. So thank you very much.